HarperCollins presents The Deadly Spark by Roxie Key, read by Imogen Wilde. Prologue. I stop as close to the cliff's edge as I dare. I allow myself a few deep breaths before grabbing the phone from my pocket. Hot tears prick at my eyes, threatening to trickle down my face, but I can't lose my nerve. Limbs trembling and palms clammy, I inhale the cool summer evening air as I take in the view. The grass illuminated by the sunrise, blades ruffling with every breath of wind. The sea glittering for miles, the horizon unbroken. The thundering noise of the waves crashing over the rocks below sounds closer than it actually is. Almost 300 feet to the bottom. Such a long drop. The sensation of the phone vibrating in my hand makes me start. Without looking at the glowing screen, I hurl it into the ocean with as much force as I can muster, watching it sail through the air before being swallowed by the dark depths below. A spike of adrenaline burns through my body as I envisage myself stepping over, imagining the sensation of my body slicing through the cold air, plummeting into the darkness of nothing. I take a step closer. Just a few meters away now. Any minute. The sound of a dog barking in the distance makes me jump, and I turn on the spot, squinting in the weak light. Then, I see him. And he sees me. I don't have much time. I turn back to face the edge of the cliff, break into a run up the grassy slope, and leap. Chapter 1. Eve. Now. The Fitbit on my wrist performs a celebratory buzz as I hit my daily step count target. It's not even 6 a.m., I think to myself smugly, slowing to a fast walk so I can chuck some water down my throat. I live for this time of year. The sun rises before 5, and I'm usually out the door shortly after, trainers on, the coastal wind whipping my face as my feet pummel the pavement that leads to the beach. "Take that, Bells," I say out loud as my avatar slides into first place. DC Bella Cortez and I have been competing for as long as we've known each other. On my first day in the CID as a detective constable 5 years ago, she'd added me to the team's step count competition. Within a couple of weeks, everyone else had dropped out, but Bella and I never stopped taunting each other. We soon progressed to lunch dates, post-shift drinks, and wild ideas of running the Brighton Marathon together to raise money for the Sussex Police Charitable Trust. It hasn't happened yet, but our friendship has grown stronger and stronger. I pause to lean against the rusting promenade railings, pastel turquoise paint tarnished beneath my fingers, and watch the sea lapping against the pebbled shore. It's my morning ritual, enjoying the peace before the usual onslaught of selfie-snapping tourists and ever-ravenous seagulls. Just me, and anyone else mad enough to be up at this time. My phone vibrates in my arm strap, shattering the peace of the summer morning. I slide it out of its pocket and see a text from Bella. Smirking, I prepare myself for a ribbing about overtaking her again. But I flinch when I see her message. "You heard about the fire?" If there's been another arson attack, this would make it the 4th in the area this year. Our team isn't the one investigating the serial arsonist who keeps breaking into people's homes and destroying their lives, but we haven't missed it on the news. As Brighton residents, we're all too aware of the destruction fire can cause. I can't help but let my gaze drift to the sorry remains of the West Pier, burnt to a smoking carcass in 2003. I remember standing on the pebble beach with my jaw hanging open, gripping my mum's hand as we watched it go up in flames. But another memory, far more recent, is the one that sends a shiver snaking down my spine, and I send a silent prayer of thanks that I, Detective Constable Eve Starling, am not on this case. Stale air pumps into the incident room, the sound of the ancient air conditioning unit buzzing in my ears. DCI Gillian Harbrook rushes through the door in an emerald green suit tailored to her tall, athletic frame, clutching files to her chest in one hand, a coffee in the other, and her phone wedged between her ear and shoulder. Not for the first time, I wonder if I should make more of an effort with my appearance. Gillian burns bright in outlandish colours I've got zero hope of pulling off. I smooth out my plain white tee, worn with my usual dark blue jeans and a black leather jacket slung over the top, my feet shoved into Converse trainers. A black mane spirals from my head, refusing to be tamed. Judging by her tone, the conversation isn't going well, and I feel grateful not to be on the receiving end. She has the unique ability to be utterly terrifying and likeable in equal measures, a combination I find both puzzling and fascinating. She knows how to switch her warm Geordie accent into something far frostier. I live in fear of disappointing her. Gillian ends the call abruptly and sets everything down on the table. "Absolute arsehole," she mutters, reaching for the remote control for the projector screen. She turns to me, honey-coloured hair falling in a neat crop around her tanned face, which she arranges into a calm smile. "Eve, you're early." I pull out a chair. "Just needed 5 minutes. The others are on their way." "Everything okay?" Her expression tells me it's a loaded question. I know she's remembered the anniversary is tomorrow. "Probably best I'm keeping busy." I offer up a half smile. "Good." She approaches me and rests a hand on my shoulder. "If you need anything, you know where I am, pet." I smile, but I feel awkward, wanting to project a strong, capable image. "I'll be fine." She considers me for a moment. "I know you will." Her hand drops. "How's the new recruit getting on?" "Tiana?" I search my brain, having barely paid any attention to DC Tiana Banks, a slight dark-skinned woman who wears her afro hair tied back from her pixie-like face. Fine, I think. I haven't had much of a chance to talk to her yet." The reality is, I'm harbouring bitter feelings towards her for swanning into the CID on a fast-track scheme, bright-eyed and bushy-tailed, a detective at the age of... well, I haven't thought to ask. I know how petty it sounds, but I've done my time in uniform, years on the beat, exam after exam, earned my detective constable status. I took my sergeant's exam months ago, hungry for the next stage, refreshing the internal jobs boards so often you'd think I was trying to get hold of Taylor Swift tickets. Desperate to prove I got my dream job on my own merit, and not through my connections. In Tiana's first week, I asked her to sift through some phone records, and she missed a crucial piece of information I later discovered when double-checking her work. I don't think I'd have got away with that. Gillian reads my mind. "Give her a break." Her voice softens. "She's young. And she's got potential, just like you did when you started." My cheeks flame, and I think back to when she hired me. She's the younger sister of my old next-door neighbour, Charlie. But Charlie was more than just a neighbour to me. Still is, actually. More like an uncle, making Gillian like an aunt. Maybe even a big sister. I'd grown up calling her Gilly, looking up to her in the way that teenagers often do with young adults who seem to have everything together. After my life fell to pieces, Gilly and Charlie were the only ones who looked out for me. I clung to them because there was no one else. When I graduated with first-class honours in criminology, she was the one who encouraged me to apply to be a police officer and work my way up through the ranks just like she had. I've always been unashamedly in awe of her, and secretly pleased that I have a stronger bond with her than anyone else in the team does. When she was promoted to Detective Chief Inspector, calling her Mom took a lot of getting used to. "Yes, Mom, sorry. Don't apologise. Just do me a favour," she says. "I was going to ask you this later, but seeing as you're here..." She needs a coach. She's great at problem solving, but I want her to work on her people skills and her eye for detail. That's where you come in. My eyebrows rise in surprise. You want me to mentor Tiana? It's not what I expected, but the truth is I'd dance off a cliff with a smile on my face if Gillian asked me to. Exactly. You possess the skills she needs to thrive. She's young. You can mould her. A mini Eve, if you will. I grimace. No one wants that, Mom. Gillian laughs. Just don't pass on your hot-headedness and we'll all be fine. I'm still processing Gillian's request when a commotion in the corridor signals the arrival of the others. DS Jason Hooper strides into the room like he owns it, followed by Tiana, eager to get a good seat at the table. Bella breezes in, always the coolest person in the room, the rest of the team trailing in her wake. The sound of chairs scraping is followed by the usual hushed silence that Gillian's presence solicits. She stands beside the projector screen, her arms folded and her expression serious. I love seeing her in action. In the early hours of Monday morning, a fire was set at 11 Buchanan Drive, deliberately. The fire service was called in at 3:22 a.m. You'll have seen it on the local news, no doubt. Or bloody Facebook. I dig my nails into my thighs as she continues. Why the hell has this case landed in our laps? What is this now, the fourth fire like this in the area? Jason's gaze is intense. Yes. Except this one's different. There were fatalities. She presses a button and two photographs flash up on the screen. The 999 call came in from a neighbour, but it was too late. Lisette DuPont and her daughter Sylvie died. Sylvie, she says, tapping the photo of the smiling child with eyes like chocolate buttons, was just 5 years old. I attended the postmortems yesterday afternoon and the pathologist confirmed there was soot in their lungs, making smoke inhalation the cause of death. To give you an idea of the state of the bodies, their identities could only be confirmed via dental records. A flicker of a memory seeps into the edges of my consciousness, but I bat it away. Not now. Gillian continues. The photos I'm about to show you are particularly gruesome. You may look away. But I don't. As much as I struggle, I force myself to look as two more photographs appear on the screen. Two bodies, one unmistakably a child, charred to the point of being unrecognisable. Any clothes they were wearing had completely burned away, and both their postures were curled over with flexed knees and elbows and clenched fists, like a boxer defending against a blow. I lean back instinctively, nausea swirling through my body until I'm finally forced to avert my eyes, focusing on a crumb on the carpet. Pugilistic stance, says Gillian, staring at the pictures thoughtfully. Not shielding themselves from the fire, as you might think, caused by the shrinkage and stiffening of the muscles due to extreme dehydration. I suppress a shudder. I glance over at Tiana and notice how her facial expression is neutral, as if she's not affected by the gruesome images on the screen in front of her. How does she do it? Gillian clicks onto the next slide, showing a photograph of the house cordoned off with scene tape. The fire was set from inside the house, but there was no sign of forced entry. No broken windows, no smashed locks. We can assume the perpetrator was either known to the victims or...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.